was on vacation in the Caribbean with my parents. We were staying at a beachfront hotel on San Marcos. It was December 31st, in the early afternoon of New Year's Eve. I was 15. I was sitting by the pool, reading a book, when a tall, very pretty girl, about 18, wearing a bikini, lay down in a chaise lounge next to me and began smoothing suntan oil onto her body. And I watched as she applied the lotion to her arms, her neck, her shoulders, her stomach, her calves and her thighs. She had reddish brown hair and I could almost smell its fragrance. And I felt as though I was swooning into her. When I realized I was becoming so aroused that I had to throw a beach towel over my swimsuit. Now, I don't know if she noticed this, but after a minute or so, she leaned over and told me her name was Donna, and she was from Babylon, Long Island. And I told her my name and that I was from Manhattan. Then she asked if I'd like to take a walk with her. So we got up and strolled along the beach. And she asked me what I'd been reading. And I told her I was reading a book about relativity. About how space was not only curved, but was also a substance that could be folded in upon itself. And that if we could travel faster than the speed of light, we could look back at the Earth with a telescope and see what had happened in previous ages. And I remember that at one point I gestured rather grandly toward the ocean, and I said, "For the fish in the sea, we're in an unbreathable world here above the surface of the water." And then she interrupted me and asked if I'd ever kissed a girl. And I said, "No, I never had." And she asked me if I'd like to kiss her. And I said, "Yes, I would." And I leaned forward and kissed her on the cheek. And she laughed and said, "You are the sweetest boy." And I got red in the face and I could feel my ears burning. And then she said, "Have you ever kissed a girl like this?" And she leaned forward and held my head in her hands and kissed me, easing her tongue into my mouth. And I thought I was going to pass out. And I loved her more than anything else in the world at that moment. And then she drew me down with her onto the sand. And while we continued kissing, she worked her hand inside my swimming trunks. And she held me. The first time a girl had ever touched me there. And when I came, it took about 2/3 of a second. She laughed. And then, very gently, she withdrew her hand and walked down to the water's edge where she washed it off. She said, "Are you all right?" I said, "I'm a little embarrassed." And she said, "Oh, don't be. That was beautiful." And I thought, how could that have been beautiful for her? How could she possibly have enjoyed that? Then we both swam for a while. And later, we walked back up the beach, and when we parted at the hotel's registration desk, she gave me her phone number in Babylon. Stalls where vendors were selling their wares, cassavas, yams, bananas, painted coconuts, woven mats, baskets, carved wood statues. and it was a smoking grill with chickens and fish, and a man selling beer from a barrel filled with ice cubes. And as I walked up and down the aisles, I heard a woman's voice saying, "Hello." And I looked up, and there was this beautiful, dark-skinned island girl wearing a pink house dress, leaning against a pile of crates, smoking a cigarette. And I said, "Hello." And she said, "Want a date?" And I thought she was a fruit vendor selling dates. And I said, "A date?" And she said, "You don't know what I'm talking about, do you?" And I said, "No." And she said, "Would you like to come upstairs and be together with me? Do you have any money?" I only had $5, which I showed her. And she said, "That's fine. Come on. We'll do it for love." And the next thing I know, I'm following her up two flights of rickety wooden steps, wondering, can this really be happening? She unlocks a door and leads me into a bedroom. The wood plank floor is painted green, the color of deck paint, and there's a bed with a towel draped over it, a bank calendar on the wall just above it, and a light bulb hanging from the ceiling with a pull cord. In the corner, there's a faucet and a ceramic basin with a pitcher. She asks me my name and tells me her name is Jasmine. "Do I have a girlfriend?" "No," I say. Then she says, "Wait a minute." And she goes into the bathroom and comes out a little later, naked. And she undresses me and examines me to make sure I don't have any lesions or pustulating sores. And then she washes me with soap and water, saying, "I want to make you nice and clean for me." She takes my hands and guides them over her body and walks me over to the bed and says, "Lie down on your back. I'll give you a treat." And I lie down, and she kneels down next to me and begins to kiss my stomach, causing my stomach muscles to twitch and spasm because I've never been kissed there before. Then she runs her tongue over her lips, and I can feel her hot breath on me just before she takes me into her mouth. And then, instinctively, I put my hands on her head because the sensation is so intense. And though her hair looks frizzy, it feels surprisingly soft. And her eyes are closed, and she's moaning. And I notice she has a crucifix around her neck, a little gold crucifix with Jesus hanging from the cross. Gala dinner dance at the hotel ballroom. An orchestra dressed in white tuxedos played on the proscenium stage at one end of the room, while above the dance floor, a disco ball with little reflective mirrors turned slowly, throwing off a splash of moving snowflake lights throughout the entire ballroom. I was sitting at a large table with my parents, their adult friends, and their children. We were sampling hors d'oeuvres and drinking champagne. And among my parents' friends who'd come down to San Marcos with us were the Brickmans, a married couple with their son, Buddy, who lived a few doors down the hall from us in our apartment building in Manhattan. Buddy and I were friends. We rode our bikes, went to the park, played baseball, and snuck into movies together. Mrs. Brickman was a tall, leggy brunette. I think she fancied herself a femme fatale. Back in New York, her behavior toward me when we were alone was often insinuating and seductive. Once, when I was only 13, we were in the living room of her apartment waiting for Buddy to come home from his violin lesson when she told me how bored she was. Her husband had lost interest in her, wasn't very energetic anymore, wasn't the man he used to be. Then she said when she'd been my age, she'd had a boyfriend, Maurice, and they'd had the most wonderful afternoons when his parents were out of the house. She'd never forgotten them. And she talked about how girls were more sexually advanced than boys, and how, when she and her girlfriends got together, all they'd talk about were boys' pike staffs. I love to pet them and make them stand up, she said. And then she added, you probably think I'm drunk, don't you? I said, no, Mrs. Brickman. Then she wanted to know if I'd ever been with a girl. Had anyone touched me all over? Had I ever kissed a girl on her special spot? I told her I hadn't. And then she dropped her cigarette case and bent down to pick it up, and her blouse fell open and I could see her breasts, and I remember her looking up and seeing me looking at them. And red-faced, I turned away to look out the window. When she came up behind me, put her hand on my arm, and stood so close I could feel her breath on the back of my neck. And she said, if I asked you to go away with me for the weekend, would you? At first, I didn't understand. For me, going away for the weekend meant driving to the country, swimming in a lake, playing sports, maybe going into town at night to see a movie. I said, do you have a country house? And she said, no, but I know a beautiful inn that we could go to. And being only 13 years old, I had the image of a medieval inn with wenches carrying trays of roasted meat to long trestle tables and placing them next to tankards of ale, men singing drinking songs and then breaking out into swashbuckling sword fights, swinging down from the rafters on ropes. I mean, what did I know from an inn? Apparently, she had in mind some sleek Southampton private getaway. But before I could answer her, we heard Buddy coming in the front door. And now, it was New Year's Eve, and I was in this packed hotel ballroom in the Caribbean, and I just couldn't help staring at Mrs. Brickman, who looked so gorgeous, wearing a low-cut, off-the-shoulder gown. She was a little bit drunk, telling everyone at the table how her husband, Bernard, had just acquired a Ferrari F355 and they were going to take a road trip through Europe. When, almost on cue, Bernard approached the table. He was considerably older than she, in his mid-60s at least, and he leaned forward rather formally and asked her to dance. And she reached up and playfully tugged at his tie and said, oh, Bernard, loosen up. He got beet red. And then, turning to everyone at the table, she said, does anybody know what time it is? I know what time it is. And she drew a very expensive Waltham gold watch from Bernard's vest pocket. And she began to spin it around her head by the gold chain. And Bernard's face went ashen. And Buddy, their son, got up abruptly and left the table. And when the chain broke, and the watch flew off and hit a nearby pillar, Bernard just turned on his heel and stormed off. But no one else paid much attention to this because they were all talking and drinking and watching the crowded dance floor, and the music was almost deafening. And I jumped up from my chair, rushed to the base of the pillar, and picked up the broken crystal and the tiny gears and springs and arms that had fallen off. And I brought the watch in pieces and fragments over to Mrs. Brickman and asked her if she'd like me to put it aside for her. And she said, yes, thank you. Why don't you take it up to your room? I'll get it later. And so, holding the smashed remains of the watch in my cupped hands, I rode an elevator to my floor, walked to my room, unlocked the door, and went in. And I placed the remains of the watch on the dresser. When I realized that Mrs. Brickman was standing in the doorway behind me, I was so stunned that my hand jerked and accidentally brushed some of the springs and gears off the top of the dresser, and I watched them fall and disappear into the rug. And I looked down helplessly and said, oh no. And she waved it off. Oh, it's nothing, she said. It doesn't matter. We'll get another one. She was holding an open bottle of champagne, and she kicked off her shoes and sat down on the bed. And then she asked me to go to the bathroom and bring a glass so that we could both drink together. And she poured the champagne into the glass, drank off half of it, her eyes tearing up, handed me the glass, and I drank down the rest of it and felt a sudden warmth in my stomach, and I was immediately lightheaded. And she said, I have to kiss you. Will you kiss me? And I said, yes. And she gave me a deep, voluptuous kiss, then slipped out of her dress. And she had a beautiful body. And my heart was pounding so hard, I could feel the blood hammering in my ears. And she asked me, do you like what you see? You can have it. I want you to have it. I want you inside me. Hurry. And later she said, do you hate me for this? And I said, I could never hate you. And then I almost asked her if she would tell my parents. My legs were so shaky, I didn't even try to lift myself from the bed. And she got dressed. I have to go back downstairs, she said. Are you all right? I said I was. And she left. A minute or so later, there was a knock on the door. Thinking she'd come back, I got up, walked across the room, and opened the door. And it was Buddy, her son. He stared at me, standing naked in front of him, stared at the disheveled bed, the empty champagne bottle, the air still heavy with the smell of sex. He'd probably seen his mother come out of my room, looking ravished, drunk. And he punched me, and I went down. Then he turned and left. Sitting at the outdoor bar of the veranda of the hotel, overlooking the ocean. I'm nursing a bruise under my left eye with a folded napkin filled with chipped ice. And I'm drinking a banana daiquiri. The bar is crowded with people sitting at tables and dancing to the music of a small island band. The men in short sleeves, the women in cotton sundresses. There are a lot of floral patterns, lots of tanned arms and shoulders and calves. And I look down at the beach, where there are groves of palm trees and cabanas and flaming torches set in the sand. When an older man, wearing a white linen suit, sky blue shirt, and alligator slip-ons, sits down next to me. His skin is darkly tanned, and his teeth are perfectly white and even. He's lean, fit, athletic. His gray hair combed straight back, looking sleek, streamlined. He glances at me and says, "Beautiful disagreement. At first, I don't understand. Your cheek," he says. "Oh, no, I just bumped into something. Are you here with your mom and dad?" "Yeah." "How long have you been down here?" "A week." "Then I guess you'll be going home soon. Tomorrow morning." "Well, my name is Reed," he says. "What are you drinking?" "A banana daiquiri. Fully loaded." "What?" "Has it got any rum in it? Island rum. The specialty here on San Marcos." No, I think I've already drunk too much." "Well, you know, we produce our own brand of rum here. It's called the Purple and Gold Label. Have you tried it?" "No, I haven't." "Well then," he says, "let me order you a real daiquiri with some of our island rum in it. You'll be fine. No one's gonna ask you to fly the plane home." And he turns to the bartender. "I'd like another proper banana daiquiri for my friend here, and I'll have another one of these." And he holds up his own glass. I ask him, "Do you live here?" "Yes, I do," he says, "all year round. Out there." And he points to a large ocean-going luxury yacht, lit up like a Christmas tree, anchored about 100 yards offshore. And I ask him, "What do you do?" "Well, I work in offshore salvage. You know, old shipwrecks. As a matter of fact, we just recovered a Spanish galleon that went down in the 17th century. And, well, among other things, we found several skeletons of people who were chained below deck." "Who were they?" "Well, they might have been crew members who got out of line. Maybe they were slaves taken for transport. It's really hard to know. There's nobody left to tell a story. Anyway, there's a virtual pirate's treasure out there," he said, pointing at the cabin cruiser. "We've got silver plates, gold ingots, helmets, cutlasses, doubloons. Say, you want to come out and take a look?" No, I think I'll just stick around here." "Well, we'll be back in less than an hour. Come on. What do you want to do? Sit at the bar for the rest of the evening? You've seen everything that's going to happen here." It was my last night on the island. And so, we walked through the hotel lobby, and we drove down a long, winding road, fragrant with the scent of tropical flowers, the moon hooded behind some clouds, and pulled up at the dock. And then we walked down a pier, the water gently lapping against the sides of the boats, until we came to a long, slender speedboat, painted silver with red trim, that looked like a rocket. And then we were skimming across the top of the water, and I could see the lights of the harbor and the hotel receding into the distance. We pulled up alongside the cabin cruiser, freshly painted white and Mediterranean blue, with a large open rear deck and portholes just above water level. And we tied and anchored the boat and climbed a rope ladder to the deck. And then he led me into a stateroom, all rubbed wood furniture, old brass fixtures, Persian rugs, crystal decanters filled with liqueurs, and he poured a glass for me and a glass for himself. And then he unlocked a large safe and showed me a sword with barnacles encrusted along the surface that had lain beneath the Caribbean Sea for over 300 years. And he asked me if I'd like to hold it. Then he slipped a helmet onto my head and said, "Why, it fits perfectly. Look at that. We have a young conquistador." And he walked to the other side of the room, opened a cabinet drawer, and drew out a small mahogany box, brought it over to me and said, "This is old, ancient. It's of North African origin. It's been in the family of one of my servants for many years. You can see it's inscribed with verses from the Quran. And the key to this box hangs on the chain around my neck. Now let me open the box and show you what's in it." And he unlocked the box and drew out what looked like a thick cigarette wrapped in brown paper. It bore on one end the gold stamp of a crescent moon with a single star held in its horn. And he lit it and inhaled deeply, his eyes watering slightly, the corners of his mouth turned up in the hint of a smile. And then a blue cloud of fragrant, oily, heavy smoke extended in a graceful plume from his mouth. "Would you like to try it?" "I don't think so," I said. "You will never in your life have a chance like this again. If I were you, I would not pass this up. I would not let this go by. This is rare. Come on, what harm?" And he handed me the thick brown cigarette, and I took a deep drag, and then another, and another, and the effect was electrifying. I felt a sense of deep peace. That life, that had been such a struggle for me, that it seemed so difficult to navigate, was suddenly revealed as benign and beautiful. And I took another drag on that brown cigarette and thought about Donna and then Jasmine and how beautifully they'd made love to me. And my heart went out to both of them. And I thought of Mrs. Brickman and realized the desperation and loneliness that drove her, and understood her misery in a way I never had before. And I thought about Mr. Brickman and the tragedy of his situation, of living with a woman considerably younger than he, who was casting about for more youthful lovers. And I suddenly saw him as tragic too. This poor man, for all his wealth, was powerless. For all his power, was helpless. And then I thought about their son, Buddy, who had rightfully hit me. And I felt ashamed about what I'd done to him. Poor, poor Buddy, child of a tragic union. And my remorse became exquisite. And I thought of everyone on this earth as brothers and sisters, and felt an emotion bordering on ecstasy. I was one with the world, connected to everything in a way I'd never realized before. A child of the universe. It was almost as though Donna and Jasmine and Mr. and Mrs. Brickman and Buddy and this man called Reed and I, almost as if we were the same person, cut from the same piece of cosmic cloth. We're all made of atoms, I thought. We're all the same energy. We're all the same cosmic dance. Nothing can separate us. I noticed the pitching of the sea, and a wave of nausea washed over me, and I said, "Where's the bathroom?" pointed. The head's below, down the companionway. You'll see, it's marked. And I staggered down a narrow stairway and into the bathroom. And I threw up into the toilet. And then, dizzy, white as a sheet, trembling and perspiring, I went into a stateroom and lay down on the bed. When I heard him come in and felt him lie down next to me, naked. And the last thing I remember is the sensation of his lips on the back of my neck. Shacks on stilts with walls made of corrugated metal and shipping crates and parts of barrels. Palm fronds are used as roofing, and jerry-rigged electrical wiring draws power from the cables along the main road. You see the blue smoke from cook fires, hear the sound of the island music, and the young women are sashaying in the street, barefoot. Their eyes flashing, their teeth white as pearls, their long, slender figures beckoning, their reed-thin bodies receptive, open.
There comes a time in life when there's nowhere else to go for the answers and for the questions that we have about life. When we don't have the capacity to do what we'd like to do, when we make mistakes, when things don't turn out the way we'd like to see them turn out, what's the reason? What happens? What do we do with all that? I know many people who are very frustrated because they aren't somebody else, because they don't have the ability that other people have. I've gone through that, and I still labor under it somewhat. Makes us miserable because we're not as capable or as smart or perhaps as powerful or as rich as somebody else. But there is a statement that I'd like to share with you today, and I hope it helps, from Isaiah 45. Listen to the 9th verse. Woe to him who quarrels with his maker, to him who is but a potsherd among the potsherds on the ground. Does the clay say to the potter, what are you doing? Or making? Woe to him who says to his father, why have you begotten? Or to his mother, what have you brought to birth? I know that there are a lot of things maybe you'd like to do, or perhaps be, or turn back the hands of time. But we are what we are. And there's a great sense of peace that we can achieve by just accepting that. It's true that we have to learn from mistakes and try to undo some of the things we've done that shouldn't have been done. But what's important is to proceed and to just realize that God has given you certain capabilities, a mind, certain spirit, and He's also given you time. that as we go through time, lots of changes take place. And the peace that comes to us is to know that we can fit into God's plan for our lives. Lord, we want to accept your work in our lives. And to not be stressed out or to be anxious because things aren't the way we want them to be. We're just thankful for each day, for the lessons you teach us, and for the opportunities you give us to correct some of the mistakes we've made. We'd ask you to help us just be at peace with all of that as we think about our lives in a relationship to you. In our Lord we pray. Amen.
Just imagine, if you will, the most spectacular sunset you've ever seen, or the most perfect fragrant rose. They have nothing over you. As a God being, you are an exquisite ray of divine beauty and infinite loveliness. This is the absolute truth of you. It's the absolute truth of all of us. But sometimes we get hooked into society's criteria of beauty and we forget. We tend to judge ourselves by the world's standards, even while giving lip service to the truth. It's so easy to identify ourselves at times with our outer appearance. In truth, the inner self is who we are, and this self is wholeness, loveliness, radiance, and light, for it is God. If only we could see the perfection of our own being, how could we think we're anything less than excellent in every way? There's a saying, God does not make junk. It's absolutely true, for perfection cannot beget imperfection. We say that we're made in God's image and likeness, so how can we be anything less than radiant beings of light?
We pray, O God, a gift of thanksgiving for your Son, Jesus Christ, the light of the world, the gift of hope, the gift of courage, the gift of a faith that endures. Strengthen us, O God, this day when we feel weak. Give us encouragement when we would despair. We pray for those who will tolerate Christmas with an attitude of doubt and fear. Strengthen them that they might see your love and human personality.
Hello, everyone. Happy holidays. Christmas has passed, and now we look forward to the new year. And with January 1st coming, 1999, comes a whole host of New Year's resolutions that we usually get ourselves into. Oh, it could be anything from treating our neighbor, our spouse, our children better, to losing weight, to trying to earn more money, to whatever. We make promises to ourselves, we make promises to our loved ones, we make promises to God. And after January 1st comes and goes, just a matter of days, one by one, all of our New Year's resolutions come to an end. And why is that? We have very good intentions, but it doesn't seem to last very long. Part of the problem is that we just do not understand the present nature that we live in. That is, I'm talking about our human nature. Our human nature, the Bible says, is corrupt. There's nothing to be ashamed about that. I mean, that's just the way we are. God loves us because of it, in spite of it. He loves us, and he's the remedy for it. Peter is the perfect example of someone who doesn't know himself well enough, who made a sort of a New Year's resolution, in a sense, right in the face of Jesus himself, only to see it broken just a few short hours later. Jesus, in his discourse with the disciples, Peter, of course, the bold one, the brash one, the one who was not afraid to speak his mind, was the one who said, Lord, I'm not going to wash your feet. Lord, I'm going to die with you. Lord, you know me. I'm going all the way with you. And he said, Peter, in a sense, you don't know your heart. You're going to deny me before this is over with. And Peter's thinking, how can that possibly be? So Peter's making this New Year's resolution that I will go all the way. Excuse me. The time of trouble happens. You know what happens to Peter? Not only does he deny his Lord, but he even swears, he curses, to prove that he's not a part of this group of disciples. Miserably, he walks off in a very repentative attitude and sees Jesus afar off, and then just looks one look on Jesus' face of disappointment and sadness, and it just breaks his heart, and he repents. Folks, God is not interested in our promises to him as much as he's interested in us believing with all our heart his promises directed towards us. I wish you a very happy new year, and remember, the promises that we make to the Lord are not as important as the promises that he wants us to believe that he has given us in his word. God bless, and thank you for calling Dial a Message.
Thank you.
against the background of eternity. Life is short, tactless. A hair swept aside by the great wind of existence. And so, I resolve to continue to live my life as fully as possible, through every pore of my skin to absorb it, in every villi of my lungs to breathe it, with every one of my taste buds to savor it, through every rod and cone of my eyes to see it, by every anvil, hammer, and stirrup of my inner ear to hear it. My very bowels ringing with the resonance of life's own bulwarks. Yes, I will dive into life as though it were a deep pool, knowing that in this brief and minor transit on Earth, I must not accept anything less. I will not live a beige existence. I will not be blinded. On the contrary, I'm going to experience a starburst panchromatic rainbow life full of shifting light patterns, including all the colors of the spectrum. Because life should be lived rapturously. Everything should have a delicious quality. Why, only last night I made love to a very beautiful woman in an alley. We were lying next to an overturned carton of medical waste, discarded limbs from amputations and the fatty remains of liposuction operations, and nearby there was a dead body in a dumpster. She'd hiked up her skirt and she was lying beneath me with her tongue in my mouth, her eyes clenched shut, her legs wrapped around my hips, her hair matted to the back of her neck, and grasping with one hand the rusted handrail of a stairway. When I noticed cockroaches as big as lobsters scurrying over our bodies, and I broke away, and she said, "What's wrong?" And I stood there in a panic, urinating involuntarily onto the pavement. But I am so happy tonight. I can barely express the warmth and love that beats in my heart. Because nothing, nothing could be more perfect than the way this evening has laid itself out. A simple meal, a glass of wine, a few noisemakers, a festive hat, a warm and comfortable pair of slippers, and an open microphone. Now, I want you to listen to this. How do you like that sound? Isn't that something? Doesn't that make you feel good? Doesn't that sum it all up? Doesn't that evoke the spirit of the evening? Well, how about this one? Well, it has a different, ironic quality, don't you think? And let's listen to this one. Does that suggest, if not self-censorship in a world of limitless horizons? Three noisemakers with three ideas. Tell you how surprised I was to learn that you've been fired from your job after 30 years of loyal service. It seems impossible that you should be let go. I imagined your position would have been protected. So it came as a terrible shock when I learned that you've been given a large brown paper satchel at your desk, handed your overcoat, and told that within 5 minutes you had to leave the premises with armed guards on either side. and were thrown unceremoniously out into the street. The door slammed behind you. Your pension revoked. You were the best secretary I ever had. A fine employee. So I frankly can make no sense of what's happened. And since I have no sensible handle on how we might proceed in defending you against the impossibly murky atmosphere of hooded and shrouded allegations about you, made from quarters that are not immediately apparent, from accusers who don't make themselves known, who do not come forward, from innuendo, the planting of charges that are unclear, unfathomable, unsubstantiated, circumstantial, all of which point to your irrefutable guilt of a kind that is vague and yet compelling. So I cannot say these charges are easily dismissed or can be set aside or ignored, although I can't exactly tell you what they are, because I've signed a sworn affidavit saying that I will not, under any circumstances, even were I to learn the nature of the charges, reveal them to anyone, especially to you. And so, I want to go on record now, for anyone who might have overheard this conversation or is making a surreptitious recording of it, that although I have in the past respected you, and have been seen in public with you, and have associated with you, and signed your paychecks, and have found you to be competent, hardworking, industrious, loyal, that I completely disassociate myself from you, your relatives, your assigns, your representatives, your family, your heirs, your lieges, those who would have liens on your property, those who would speak falsely of me in relation to you, I disassociate myself entirely and remain at a distance, legally separated by a great shield, in order that whatever infection may be festering within the precincts of your own circumstances cannot in any way cause harm to me or my family, my associates, my colleagues, my heirs, or their liens and assigns. Now, having said that, I want to wish you the best of luck and tell you that I have valued these years we've had together. I will treasure them. Even though I have destroyed all evidence of their having existed and disassociate myself from that evidence, and those who might be listening or recording this conversation both explicitly and surreptitiously must know that what is in the past is irrevocably severed from the present and in no way connected to the future. So, enjoy a wonderful retirement. I want you to take with you our blessings, and when I say our, I speak of the firm, and actually not the present firm or the future firm, but the firm that was, the firm in fact of your nostalgic recollection, the firm that existed before you were summarily removed from your office and placed on the street. And please give my regards to your husband, Harold, and your children, Josh and Miriam. I know Harold's birthday is coming up, and although he's not completely recovered from the operation yet, that his convalescing is coming along in a satisfactory manner, and that Miriam's leg braces are coming off next week, and that the electronic chip at the base of Josh's spine has controlled the spasm sufficiently so that he can be removed from his harness. So, things appear to be going well for you at this time, and that must be a consolation during this stressful period in your employment history. I feel an emptiness inside me that's vast. Like interstellar space. If I began an interior journey at the speed of light, it would take me an eternity to arrive at the other side of my emptiness. And if I tried to fill my emptiness, I'd need a spigot so large it would have to be turned by a hand the size of a planet. And the torrent that would follow would be as though a single gnat were to sweat a molecule of water on a desert's burning surface. Now, what am I going to do about this? Write my congressman. Speak to a priest. Call a crisis center. Compose an angry song. Go to a wise man on a mountain. Take up juggling. Learn to play the Japanese bamboo flute. Visit Lourdes. There's a longing inside of me that's like the molten core of a volcano, like a fire raging through a forest that goes on forever. An all-consuming, overwhelming, voracious, metastasizing longing. And what am I going to do about it? How do I integrate it into my life? How do I fold it into having to go to work, talk to people, write thank you notes, make phone calls to explain why I'm going to be late, knowing that I'm not going to show up at all? Chatter. A well-known book critic holds court to a circle of effete men and masculine women who are as lifeless and maggot-ridden as carrion. And all I want to do is start screaming at the top of my lungs and hurl saucers and dinner plates. But I don't. Instead, I turn to the person next to me and say, "Would you like some more pate?" And reach into the inside vest pocket of my jacket, pull out my 9mm Glock handgun, and shoot down everyone at the table. I do it in a dispassionate, offhanded way, giving no warning. On the surface, my act seems completely inexplicable, for no reason at all. My dinner companions lie in twisted, bloody heaps on their chairs and on the floor. One of them is slumped forward, his face buried in a large plate of bratwurst. Then I calmly put the gun back in my jacket pocket and continue my disquisition on Irish scribes of the 16th century. And later, when I return to my room at the Hotel de Ville, I pour myself a drink. And as the low light of evening spreads and the shadows lengthen against the city of Aswan, I gaze down at the narrow alleys where yellow, white, and blue houses seem to be falling drunkenly, one upon the other. And I wonder why it's such a relief to perform certain acts and so painful to perform others. And why is it that some strive and struggle to do what others flee from? Standing in an outfield, her baseball cap turned around backwards, wearing a t-shirt, a friendship bracelet made of twine, and a pair of cut-off jeans. She should be barefoot. Her name, Bradley. Megan. Lindsay. Akobe. I need to rake the leaves in my head. I need to be beaten with brambles. I need to be wretchedly governed. I need to disgrace the king. I need an opera singer large enough to destroy a skyscraper. I need a connecting cable between me and someone's uterus. I need to pour a tablespoon of heavy oil in a large pot over medium-high heat, gradually whisking, and add blanched and crumbled gorgonzola cheese and scrubbed mussels which have been waiting in a pot of melted butter. Then I'll pour it over ground tortellini and serve it with a side of Polish garbanzo bean salad with peppered harissa, lingonberry preserves, a deep dish cheddar crush with soft cornmeal pretzel, and mustard and poppy seeds ground over an orange-scented crab cake with yam chips and a leek herb roasted turkey sauce, finally sprinkled with morel mushrooms, Brussels sprouts, crushed Belgian spice cookies, and giblets layered over an apricot and raisin, pumpkin spiced mousse with cinnamon, sugar, pecans, extruded pear dressing, and a pound of jam-filled roasted thumbprints. The mental hospital where I was committed resembled an old, crumbling Victorian mansion. Fluorescent lamps flickered uncertainly in the hallways. Life there was uneventful until the new director was brought in. And on his first walking tour of the facility, upon passing beneath the pulsing strobe-like fluorescent bulbs, fell victim to an epileptic seizure, his body racked by spasms and convulsions, and in a state of overheated sexual ecstasy, remained with an erection for 90 days, ejaculating multiple bodily fluids, including semen, blood, spinal fluid, gastric juices, bone marrow, brain tissue, and finally, excrement. He was buried in the courtyard after a public viewing in which we inmates shuffled by, some of us silently touching him, kissing his forehead, others dropping emblems of respect into the casket. A bouquet of dried flowers, a pair of broken glasses, a coin from the Republic of Serbia, an ivory cigarette holder, until the coffin was piled high, like a parody of a Viking funeral ship. And then it was taken to the courtyard and set ablaze, its ashes buried beneath a flower bed. Last night, Dr. Rieger told me the operation was unsuccessful. The procedure would have to be repeated, and that my health insurance wouldn't cover it. We were in my room at Cedars-Sinai, and as my hands began to tremble and my eyes welled up with tears, Dr. Rieger removed his stethoscope from his leather bag, took his own pulse, turned to me, and began to speak of his ex-wife. You know, Madeline was an extraordinary woman. She was educated, beautiful, a talented watercolorist, a brilliant cook. But I'll never forget that winter in Palm Beach, the night we were at the Boca de Cristo, and I saw her staring at Sandro. It was Christmas. The hospital staff was in good spirits. Even the people emptying the bedpans and the workers in the morgue. There were Christmas decorations everywhere. Paper cutout Santas and candy canes suspended from the operating room ceiling. The hallways were filled with elves with sacks of toys slung over their shoulders and sleighs pulled by reindeer and mistletoe. And I'd hear nurses and orderlies talking about Christmas parties and trips home and how they were trimming and decorating their trees. And being in the hospital at a time like this was particularly depressing. Amidst the swirl of activity and excitement and camaraderie and goodwill. So, that night, I packed my bag, took a cab to the airport, and flew to South America. And I got a job as a translator in Paraguay. I had a small one-bedroom cottage by the river. I like to spend my evenings at the cantina, drinking the blue mezcal. Just look at this. Carpenter creates living thing from tree stump. Wandering down an aisle in a department store when a sales clerk comes up to me and says, "Can I help you?" And I am dumbstruck by the very concept. I could say, "Yes, thank you. I do need help. Life seems meaningless to me. I'm making less and less sense to myself." But of course I don't. Because I know the narrow and limited way the question is meant. So I tell her, "I'm looking for bedroom furniture." And 15 minutes later, in home furnishings, I lie down on a Sealy Posturepedic mattress. I brought with me a pair of pajamas and my own portable radio that I listen to when I go to bed at home. And with a salesman sitting in a nearby chair, I prop myself up on one elbow, reading a copy of Women Who Run With the Wolves, until I fall asleep. And I have a dream of a world where there is no privation, no hunger, no disease, where doors are never locked. Where there is room enough and food enough and work enough for everyone. Where there is no longer a disproportionate distribution of wealth. A world in which you can call up an agency and a woman will come to your apartment, whether it's to clean your closets and organize your shelves, or to put her hair in pigtails. And then I wake up. The sound of children's laughter in the hospital room above the playground. I'm in the day room at a retirement home. A television plays Oprah in the corner. An elderly man sitting before it has fallen asleep in an old wicker wheelchair. Others stare vacantly, some drooling. Everyone in the room in various stages of decrepitude. But there was a time, long ago, when they played hopscotch, pin the tail on the donkey, when they swung from monkey bars, chased one another in games of tag, jumped rope, climbed trees, and lay on their backs in the grass, gazing up at the shifting shapes of clouds. And on their way back from the beach or the country, were enfolded, sleeping, in the arms of their loving parents, who knew that there, in that shining child, lay the future. And now, this is the future. Well, welcome to life. Have a seat. Make yourself comfortable. Here, have a pillow. Would you like a glass of urine? A beaker of shit? Ask me what time it is, and I'll tell you how the watch is made. I grow older. Grains of sand are falling in the hourglass of my life, and the bottom is fuller than the top. I know how much sand is spilled out, but I don't know how much is left above me. Time is like a river that rushes along, carrying everyone in it toward the great sea of oblivion, in which we all must drown. Time is like a wall that grows and encircles us, until finally cutting us off entirely from everyone we love. Jeroboam of champagne on the balcony of a hotel overlooking the Caribbean, where the trees dance in the island breezes, and you can see, standing on the bridge of a passing cruise ship, maidens with pearls in their hair. And a time to reach deep down into my vest pocket to retrieve from it the Ingram watch that has, since my father's death, run backwards. A time to swallow oyster shells and tinker bells. And a time to have a seizure. Because everything else has failed. And a time to close my eyes and watch on the back of my eyelids, as though projected from the rear of my head, an unedited NC-17 rated film of my life, beginning with the severing of my own umbilical cord and ending with the turning off of my life support in Technicolor. My head as though a great amphitheater with 10,000 seats, each one occupied by a brain cell, all eating popcorn, hot dogs, nachos with cheese and salsa, raisinettes, milk duds, bonbons, and drinking orange sodas and Pepsis and Diet Cokes. And I'm sitting there, watching this film, becoming increasingly agitated as my life is spilled out onto the screen. And I think, what a waste and a failure. And I get up wearily and leave the theater. Once I had a girlfriend with a tattoo of a dusty road leading to a farmhouse with a peaked roof, a red chimney, gingham curtains in the windows. A little girl sitting on a swing that hung from one of the branches of a spreading chestnut tree. And in the distance, you could see cows grazing in a field of summer wheat and a winding deep blue river bordered by pine trees. And further off, purple snow-capped mountains. And off to the left, there was a small town with a gas station, a few restaurants, some retail outlets, a movie theater, a municipal courthouse. And on a hill overlooking the town, there was a church where a service had just ended, and the minister was shaking hands with the parishioners as they left. And people were getting into pickup trucks, SUVs, old sedans, VW buses, and they were driving off. And one night, as we made love, I leaned forward to kiss her soft and gently curving flank, burying my face in her tattoo. And I could hear the wind through the leaves and the trees, the murmur of the river, the hum of crickets, and her skin tasted like the earth itself. And the next thing I knew, I was lying in a field of tall grass under an old oak tree, dappled moonlight filtering through its leaves, a river running nearby. Well, at first I thought I was dreaming. I tried to shake myself out of it, but it didn't work. I was still there, alone, in that rural setting. Somehow, I'd been absorbed into her tattoo. Seemed to be anything I could do about it. And the worst thing I could do now was panic. So I picked myself up and I began to walk through a meadow. And nights and days passed. I wandered, sleeping in the woods, eating berries and roots and drinking from the river. Until finally, after a week or so, I began to feel faint. I realized I was starving. I had to earn money so I could buy some food. So I walked into town and looked for a job. But it was a depressed area. The mill had closed down. The mine had ceased to operate. Half the storefronts were boarded up. There was no work anywhere. Finally, I was forced to spend the night in a mission. I sat in a room crowded with tired, unshaven men and listened to a 40-minute sermon. Then we ate sandwiches, took showers, put on fresh pajamas issued by church volunteers, and went to bed. The mission was near the waterfront, next to the railroad tracks. The building shook whenever a train rumbled by.
You've been listening to Joe Frank at the Dark End of the Bar. Created by Joe Frank in collaboration with David Rapkin, with musicians James Harrah, guitar, Walt Fowler, trumpet, Mike Boito, keyboard, Danny Frankel, percussion, Kenny Lyon, bass, David Brown, saxophone, Dave Ralicke, trumpet, and vocalist Perla Batalla. Technical production by Jeff Hogan and Scott Fritz. Production assistance by Esme Gregson. This has been a Joe Frank production.